call the December 20th, 2016 Shelburne Selectboard meeting to order. First item is to consider approval of the agenda. There's a couple of changes. We're fortunate to have Kyle Bergeron with us to be considered for appointment as a full-time member to the Natural Resources and Conservation Commission. We'll jump on that first thing, if everyone agrees. 6A, after our normal opening remarks. And number 12, we can remove because I was informed a few minutes ago that the Barretts cannot make it here tonight. And
number 3.
14. And number 3 we can eliminate because for tonight, because the meeting minutes, the person, the professional we hired to do had didn't have time to make the minutes this week. And number 14, we had a something happen this last month. I don't remember the exact date, but we could add as 14A, consider filing an appeal to Vermont Railway's multi-sector general permit for the intermodal facility in Shelburne.
Move to approve as amended.
Moved by Colleen. Seconded?
Second.
Seconded by Jerry. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that passes. Next up, we'll skipping over number 3, number 4, public comments. This is the time during the meeting where if anyone has something they'd like to say over which this board has jurisdiction that is not on tonight's agenda, please speak. Okay, hearing none, it's next is select board comments. Josh, do you have anything?
Nothing other than actually to repeat Jerry's comment from last week that we hope for peace on earth.
Jerry, you have anything?
Yeah, a couple of comments. I'd like to recognize the retirement of Bob Worcester, who, after 23 years of diligent and loyal and skillful work for the town, is retiring at the end of the month. And we wish him Godspeed and every happiness in his retirement. I'd also like to recognize Kate Mitchell, who was leaving us for better and other things, or no?
Joe, why don't you address it during your manager's report? Because I'm sure you're going to talk about Bob Worcester also. So.
Oh, am I mistaken?
It's okay.
Well, I was going to do an update on my town manager's report, but.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
Well.
Yeah. Stay on. Just push the hold button there.
And because it is the holidays, I do second Josh's sentiment that we wish for peace on earth and goodwill to everybody.
Colleen?
Thank you.
Colleen, do you have anything?
No.
John?
I'm okay. Thank you.
I'd like to say we had a very difficult meeting at our last meeting, and if the board is interested in going into executive discussion to discuss this under 313, I'd be willing to discuss that if the board wishes to.
Yes. Yeah, I would like to. So I move to move to an into an executive session.
Under 1 VSA 313 to discuss board conduct.
At the end of the meeting or no?
Well, we're about to have this meeting, and I think it might be good to talk briefly about it now. So I'd be in favor of addressing it. Does anybody second the motion?
I'll second it.
Any discussion?
If we were going to have something like that, I would have liked to be notified ahead of time.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
All right, we're gonna take a little break. Next up is item number 6A. Consider appointing Kyle Bergeron to the Natural Resources and Conservation Commission as a full-time member. Kyle, we appointed you about a year ago as a student member. Is that about right?
Yeah, it was in May.
May? And we've heard wonderful things about you. It's not surprising. When you first appeared before, it's pretty impressive. So Joe, why don't I turn it over to you?
Sure. Actually, we have two openings currently in the Natural Resource Commission. One commissioner moved out of state, and actually Michael Abrams is just going to focus on the Water Commission. That's taken up quite a bit of his time. So he stepped down, and so did one other. So there's two open spots. Gail posted the openings, and I talked to Gail about Kyle's, about promoting Kyle. And I think that, you know, Gail initially, and I understand, was concerned about setting a precedent where it's like an automatic promotion, and that shouldn't be the case. So I encouraged Kyle to just apply like anyone. But also I've known that Kyle has had an outstanding attendance record at the meetings. I don't know if he's been to every single one, but he's probably been to almost all of them. He was also at the Stormwater Summit, which is certainly not a requirement or expectation. My understanding from Gail is he's just been very a very good member of the committee. And as you can see, I think from Kyle's letter, there's been times that, you know, there was not a quorum there. And if he could have voted, that would have helped out the commission. Look, I recognize that Kyle, on his age, is young, but I think that he's shown maturity, diligence in his work, a commitment to it, and I think that he's earned this promotion. I guess I'll call it a promotion. And I think he would be as deserving as anyone else in the community who would apply, and so he certainly has my full recommendation, and I think he'll serve the community well.
Thanks, Joe.
And Gail feels the same, feels strongly the same way.
So seeing the email that Gail, who's chair of that committee, people like you, Kyle. So could you please come up to the mic, and we'll do this the way we do it for everyone. Just tell us why you'd like to be a full-time member.
Yeah, sure. So I've been on the commission since May, and it's been very interesting work. It's actually inspired me to do more of that kind of work in school too. As I said in my letter, I joined the sustainability design team, which is like trying to get more of the stuff that we're talking about on the Natural Resources Commission worked into the curriculum at CVU. So I find the work very interesting, and I think as a voting member, I could help out the committee more than as just a student member.
Great. Does anyone have any comments or questions for Kyle? Anyone in the audience have anything they'd like to add? Joe, can you tell me, is he replacing someone? So what's the length of appointment?
I mean, both of the terms that are open are until April 1st, 2019. We're not expecting you not to go to college and to stay on the commission. But, you know, certainly you might be able to serve about 2 years of the remaining term, and I think that'd be outstanding.
You're very impressive, young.
Yeah, he's done a great job. He really has.
Really great. Do you get it more from your mom or your dad?
Ooh, that's a tough one. I mean, he's here right now. So.
Yeah. All right, someone like to
political savvy.
Yeah.
So moved?
Do you want the full motion, or?
I believe.
Is that good enough?
You
and I'll second.
To move to appoint him until April 1st, 2019.
2019.
Right. Second.
Moved by Jerry, seconded by Colleen. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Congratulations.
Good job, Kyle.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you, Kyle.
All right, next item is, we forgot the town manager's report. Why don't you do the town manager's
report? Okay, you know, to be honest, I didn't have much to report, and I wasn't going to mention Kate Mitchell, but I think it's reasonable. I did send an email to the select board, 2 months ago, because we thought Kate was going to leave us, and she kind of is, for, you know, life happens, and her boyfriend, partner, took a job closer to her hometown in Kingston, New York, I believe. And so we thought we were going to lose her, but we've actually worked out an arrangement now where she is going to continue to work for us, at least for the time being. She's going to be here physically in the office for at least 2 days a week, including the DRB meetings, so she'll be able to continue to staff those and provide 10 to 15 hours of telecommuting work. And we believe that's going to work, and we're going to at least test it out for a few months. And this is a better, I guess this is better for us than going without someone there and trying to refill it. So we hope it works, and we'll see how we do.
Great. That's it?
That's it. I don't have much.
Great. Next item up is item number 7. Consider accepting zoning regulation amendments from the Planning Commission related to adult entertainment and warn a public hearing for January 10th. On December 15th, the Planning Commission, correct me if I get this wrong, being voted to pass along our proposed amendments to our zoning bylaws, which would address adult entertainment. Dean received a telephone call maybe 6 weeks ago, give or take, from a Burlington-based attorney representing someone who apparently was considering bringing an adult entertainment establishment to Shelburne. And so we took a look at our bylaws and realized that our bylaws were, like most Vermont communities, were silent on the topic. So the Planning Commission quickly worked on something. There are constitutional issues at play. First Amendment, freedom of expression rights. And there are also secondary adverse impact that are appropriately considered in determining what conditions, if any, might be appropriate for adult entertainment establishments. So tonight, I think all we're doing is accepting the report and scheduling it for a public hearing. Is that correct?
Yes, although it got just a little bit potentially more complicated this afternoon, and so I think Dean and I want to just go over a few things real quick with the board before you schedule the public hearing, because staff, anyways, on advice of the town attorney, is going to recommend a slight change to the amendments.
Okay, so why don't you, should I turn it over to
Dean? It's probably the most appropriate person to.
Now that I've arrived, PowerPoint trained, I recognize that this is on for just 10 minutes. We'll probably need all those 10 minutes.
Thanks, Mike.
So what are the changes meant to do? As this slide says, they're designed to reduce the adverse secondary impacts that are associated with adult-oriented businesses. We've transmitted the package to you in a with a memo, and I'm sure this is all familiar to you, but for the audience, we're restating it. So regulations that address impacts while not unduly limiting free speech and expression, because those things are protected by the Constitution. Is adult entertainment protected by the Constitution? Well, the Constitution says, the US Constitution says, that Congress can't make any laws abridging freedom of speech. Vermont's Constitution says something very similar. People have a right of freedom of speech. The freedom of expression is an element of freedom of speech. In the view of the courts. Courts have ruled that for the most part, prior restraints on speech and expressive conduct are unconstitutional. Gary was addressing this. I'm just getting into a bit more detail. You can't restrain without a compelling government interest, and you have to do it with as least restriction as possible. But if such expression is protected, how can we regulate them? Well, courts have said that municipalities can adopt regulations when they focus on dealing with the secondary impacts. And so that's what municipalities do. They look at the secondary impacts that are associated with adult businesses. Is there a limit And with the zoning regulations, there usually are limits. And in the case of regulations having to do with adult-oriented businesses, there are limits. We can't use zoning as a tool to do a prohibition of this type of land use. So we can't use zoning to prohibit. There must be locations that provide what is described as reasonable alternative avenues of communication. And I'm saying all this because the issue that has come to light late today is related to this. So under this proposal, how and where would the impacts be regulated? This amendment, for the benefit of the audience and people that haven't read the proposal yet, it adds definitions, it issues a permit in one zoning district, it requires a public review process, and it adds specific review criteria that people can read in detail, but they're summarized on this slide. It says, first of all, the impacts of the proposed adult entertainment business or use have to be comparable to those of a non-adult entertainment use. Furthermore, and this is where the rub is, the use can't be within 1,000 feet of a school, library, daycare, religious facility, public park, or a residential zone. The first part of that list, the school, library, daycare, religious facility, public park, those are often described as sensitive land uses, and the numbers are thought of as a buffer or a separation distance. Other requirements, they're not so much of an issue here. 150 feet from the edge of a right-of-way, which would limit the view from the right-of-way, and a 1,000-foot separation requirement. You can't have these uses concentrate, they have to spread apart. There are these others, people can read the list. But the ones that are most at issue are this one right here. What does this look like on a map? And I apologize, this is somewhat confusing, and maybe I'll hit the lights just temporarily. This is a bit of an abstraction, but this is the Route 7 corridor. What you're seeing in this diagram is all of these different requirements mapped out using a computer system, and we're blocking out the areas that are within the buffer distance of the sensitive land uses. And what that means is that after you apply all of them, you can see what's left. And what's left under this 1,000-foot separation requirement is a piece of land that's north of Harbor Industries, or the building that's north of Harbor Industries, a portion of the property that's owned by the Carroll family that they're intending to redevelop for their Rice Lumber, and then some land on the other side of the road, some of which is used by Dolan Farms Precourse. So that's what it looks like on a map after you apply all those criteria. So the issue is, does this proposal provide reasonable alternative avenues of communication? That's a requirement. We can't get into this without meeting that requirement. Does it? We, by way of additional background, the proposal was first developed with a 600-foot separation requirement modeled after a bylaw in the town of Brattleboro. Different towns have different separation requirements. I zeroed in on 600 feet for a couple of different reasons, but did so mindful of meeting this requirement. The Planning Commission, aware that there are other communities that use 1,000 feet, chose to add or increase those numbers from 600 to 1,000. And what we didn't do is look at the map to see how much impact that had. So when looking at the map and developing numbers in anticipation of this meeting tonight, this question arose. And we discussed it with the town's attorney. The town's attorney is concerned. So basically the answer is, well, it's not obviously yes, it's not obviously no, but it's limited enough to raise concerns. So the questions that, as I see it, should the select board take time to assess it warrants a hearing? Normally these events where we pass the baton from the Planning Commission to the select board are perfunctory. We just say, here it is, and the recommendation is to warn the hearing, and that's what happens. You're not bound to do that. You can receive it, and you can mull it over before you decide your next move. So should the select board take time to assess before it warrants its hearing? Maybe so.
or, and Joe will address this, if it wishes to warn a hearing now, should it modify the proposal first? It is possible for the select board to receive a document from the planning commission, look at it and decide that it wants to make a change, incorporate that change, and then warn that modified version for public hearing, whenever it is that you decide. As this next to last bullet point says, the town attorney is more comfortable with the 600-foot separation warned for hearing by the planning commission and discuss, although at this point, I believe Joe has a specific recommendation.
I have a question, if I could. Procedure, Dean. Once the select board receives something from the planning commission, if we make what's known as a substantial or significant change to that proposal,
yep,
doesn't it go back to the planning commission for review? And if so, is 1,000 feet to 600 a substantial or significant change?
Last question first. In my view, it is a substantial change. Second, the first part of that is no, there's not a requirement that it goes back for review by the planning commission. The planning commission must be informed at least 10 days before you take action. And it's up to the planning commission to decide if it wants to make comments. If it wants to make comments, then it's entitled to make those comments.
Okay, so what's your recommendation?
We spoke with Brian for 3 minutes at tops, but I think that if the select board wanted to have a more thorough review, I think that you'd have the exact same answer that we have now, that putting this forward to public hearing with the 1,000 feet may make the ordinance null and void. Therefore, I don't think it's worth spending that attorney's fees, taking the extra time when we are trying to kind of move this along at a relatively rapid clip. I think you're better served changing the language tonight and moving forward with the public hearing on January 10th, which is really the earliest we could do it anyhow. So that's my recommendation.
I just was going to interject. We have had conversations with the chair of the planning commission. We wanted to know whether or not this issue, if he was aware of what Joe's recommendation would be, would cause him to fall out of his chair. And he said it didn't cause him to fall out of his chair. His understanding of this would be that if you made this change, it's part of the process. It didn't essentially cause him heartburn to know that this might be a possibility.
I'd like to see him fall out of his chair.
Dean, could you better define reasonable alternative avenues of communication? It seems pretty...
Well, I can briefly, and I don't want this to be something where a planner is trying to explain the law, but it's useful. There is a test. It's summarized in the first bullet. And there are also a series of criteria that Topanga Press makes reference to a particular decision that I believe came from California. In the past, there was a lot of focus on the percentage of the community that was available, the amount of land that was available for that use. There was a case in Reston, Virginia, landmark case. And from that case, there was a practice that developed where courts looked a lot at the percentage of the town that this use could take place in. But more recently, what's happened is that it's been a case-by-case examination. And the test that's been suggested by this Topanga Press decision are to ask these questions. If you look at the land that this use could take place in, is it reasonable to believe that that available property would ever become available for commercial use? Is it the property reasonably accessible? And so on. You can read it. So that's the best answer I have for you right now. It passes the test.
And have you done a map to see what the 600?
Yes. Yes, we have. And the 600-foot map looks like this. And I unfortunately didn't do this so that you can do side by side. But I did do a table. I did two tables. I apologize. I just need to. So under the one 1,000-foot separation. The land that's available is 31 acres, and that's 0.2% of the town as a total, about 5 or 6% of the district as a whole. When you look at the 600-foot separation, it's 114 acres, 115 acres, and it's 20% of the district.
That's great.
Dean?
Yes.
You know, if the Planning Commission was using a number that they felt they had grounds to use, but the town attorney is using a number that basically for the same reasons, he felt that that was a reasonable number to use, what if we just split the difference? Just because 800 wasn't used in another town, does that prevent us from using it?
Well, the board is can do anything that it would like. The issue is there are jurisdictions that we can look at for a number that we could probably find a jurisdiction that uses 800. 500 and 1,000 seem to be much more common. I don't know that I've recalled seeing 800, but it's probably out there. I think the problem with just choosing a number is that just choosing a number doesn't really show that you've considered that the amount of land that's left over meets that test. And I think that was probably Brian's biggest concern, that before the Planning Commission closed its hearing, it did not, we didn't have the right software on the computer to say, okay, and here's what it, we had looked at a variation of 1,000, but not the one that the Planning Commission adopted. And I think his concern is you'd need to look at it before you say, let's just split the difference. It really should be, let's see what the amount of land that's left after applying 800. I would actually say, and I don't want to monopolize the conversation, I think that there may be that 600, you know, you might be able to do certain things 600 and not,
Look, Dean's our expert. I think he is an expert in his profession. His proposal to the Planning Commission originally had 600 feet. I think it's a no-brainer to include that language in the proposal moving forward.
I will say I did attend that Planning Commission meeting, and Jamie Hines, Planning Commission chair, his wife happens to be here, did a spectacular job leading that conversation, one that when this comes before this board and public hearing, I hope we follow making sure our discussion is content neutral and we focus on the adverse secondary impacts.
I do also want to make clear that the Planning Commission did make changes to the hearing draft that I fully support that are not related to the number. The only thing that is at issue tonight is that part of the changes that they made which relate to that separation distance.
So Dean, would you, if we follow Joe's recommendation, which seems to be your recommendation also, you would recommend first changing the language in what sections?
It's really just one section and one paragraph, and I will give you that specific paragraph. If you have what was distributed previously, it's within Article 19, and you have 19.10.8. Underneath that, you have A and B. Underneath B, there is a paragraph 2, and that's where the changes, so that some possible motion later tonight would be to move forward with the proposal as it was forwarded to you by the Planning Commission, with the exception that the numbers 1,000 in paragraph 2 would be changed to 600. So it currently reads, adult entertainment uses must not be located within 1,000 feet of the school, et cetera, those sensitive land uses. And then further on it says, if a grade school, library, et cetera, subsequently locates within 1,000, it would say 600. So that's the only impact of this discussion that we've had with the town's attorney.
Would someone like to move to warn a public hearing? To formally accept the proposed bylaw amendments from the Planning Commission change as just described by Dean. And warn a public hearing for January 10th, 2017.
So moved.
Moved by Colleen, seconded.
Second.
By Jerry. I thought that was an easier way of doing it.
I was down to B2.
Any further discussion? Is there anyone here who would like to say anything? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
And I'll take it that we will notify the Planning Commission of this change.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Outstanding, Dean.
All right, lost my agenda. I think it's probably our budget time now. Where is it? Next item is discuss fiscal year 2018 Shelburne General Fund Budget and warn a joint public hearing for January 10th with the school board. All right, Joe, it's still your budget until December 31st. So
right,
take it
my
away.
Plan is to hand over my budget per the town charter to you a few weeks early by the new year, which gives me a little bit less to do after that. So, but look, I can't, you had an introductory presentation last week, followed up by an all day special select board meeting where you heard from nearly about every line item in the budget. Not sure how much more information the board could ask for. Certainly there are some lines that Peter and I will go back through and tighten up and scrub that will have to be changed. But look, by and large, I'm trying to look for some feedback from the board. I'm not expecting any motions tonight, obviously, but I'd like to pass on to you a budget on January 1st that you feel pretty good about. And so certainly there are some things that are, you know, were not included that may be desirable to three or more select board members, and it would certainly be helpful to find that out now, balanced against, you know, what can you stomach for a tax rate increase, and are there some things that were in the budget that you think maybe shouldn't be in the budget? So, hey, I'll listen to you.
Thank you. Now, you had a, we're going to prepare a list of the things we talked about and pass them out. Is that what this is?
I did. This is the same Excel sheet. There might be some additional things.
And this is what you emailed
to us. The same Excel
us.
Sheet I emailed out. It may not be all inclusive, but I think it gives an idea. There's some extra.
Did we have one?
Yeah, I think we have one.
I have some extras there. But it basically gives an idea of some of the outstanding items and the impact that they would have, not just on the budget, but then on the tax rate and then on the property taxpayer, to give you an idea of all of those. Again, there may be some other items that you want to consider, but you know, get an idea of what each of those items mean to the budget.
Now, if I remember correctly, this off the top of my head, the proposed budget you provided us would have increased the tax rate, the municipal portion of the tax rate, by 3.4%. Is that right?
Sounds about right, yeah.
3.4.
All right, so anything we added,
I think all
would
of
only increase that unless, of course, we subtracted something.
That's right. Or if some numbers are going to hopefully tighten up naturally, just because we'll go back through and scrub them, but it's not going to tighten up like $100,000 worth. I mean, you know, there's not too much more to give. I don't want to mislead the board to think that. I mean, basically, if you're adding anything back in and you're not willing to take anything out that's there, you're increasing the tax rate.
Okay. So, Joe, what would you think if, from a procedural standpoint, you have a list of give or take 10 or 11 things here? If we just went through these one at a time, and
plus
some
would be added.
Yeah.
You could start going through.
Yeah, and then we'll go through the subtractions, if any.
Yeah. And again, I'm not looking for any motions. I'm kind of
just
going to try to feel a consensus of the board here.
Until December 31st.
Right.
All right, so let's go through the first one, open space. It's currently in at 30 grand, right?
Yeah, so this shows if you added another 30 for what the SNRCC requested, it has that impact on the property tax.
Okay, does anybody want to speak to that? Nope.
I
favor it. I don't know, are we gonna give
Joe an indication of.
Give you an opportunity to speak.
I favor adding the 30,000 to make it 60.
Okay. Yeah. And I would be in favor as well, as I spoke at the Wednesday meeting. This is one of those areas that when it's gone, it's gone. And I think given our past history, we need to, the fund is pretty low at this point. And I think even though it may increase it, the overwhelming sense of the public is that these are good things.
Okay. John, Colleen, you guys have thoughts about adding another 30,000?
Yes, I don't think that we have the appetite, or at least I don't have the appetite this year to do that. I think that, you know, maintaining the status quo to keep our budget more in line with 3% is better. So,
thank you.
I don't see anything in Gail's presentation to us. There wasn't anything that was imminent, like it was going to happen right away. And I didn't come away from that discussion feeling that, you know, there was anything that was, you know, urgent, I suppose. So,
thank you, John. Colleen?
Yeah, I echo what John said. When there has been things that have come up, they've been very forthright and active in coming to us and in explaining. And I think adding more money into that line item when we already have other things that I think take a higher priority, I just can't rationalize it.
Thank you. I'm in agreement with John and Colleen. Next is zoning enforcement. Is a you have $20,000 down. That would be the halftime position that hasn't been that we talked about a year ago. That was never filled, right?
It's not in the budget proposal here. It's in the current year. I didn't get a feeling from anyone on the board that you were looking to put that in.
Okay. Does anybody want to add that in?
No.
No. No. No. Jerry?
No.
No. Okay. No. Okay. So no, no.
That was a little bit easier, guys.
Cell antenna revenue loss. It's $39,000. Now, this is something, and again, all this is off the top of my head. It used to be, give or take, the Water Commission would get 30-some-odd percent. 30% and the town would get 70%.
Right.
I had thought we were going to switch to a 50-50 this year. Now, that was before you two were on the board, so there's nothing holding anybody to that, but that was the general thought, I think, that the three of us had agreed to a year ago. But in your budget, didn't you make it more to the Water Commission?
The Water Commission's recommendation from their last meeting was for the FY 2018 budget to reflect 65% to the Water Commission and 35% to the Select Board. It's in there now.
I'm in favor of a 50-50, this split, with the hope that next year we would then increase it to more of a 75% to the water and 25% to the town.
I think what I remember from the discussion a year ago was we were going to make the change in two steps.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So we were going to go like 50-50, but we never said 50-50. We were going to make a step, and then next budget cycle make another step, and then the third year it would be all to the Water Commission.
And that's exactly where I'm coming up with 50% this year, 75 next year, and 100% the next year, of course, dependent upon whatever the makeup of the board is at the time.
Right. And that's what I remember.
Yeah. All right, does anyone have any different thoughts?
Yeah,
or?
Yeah, I mean, and I apologize since obviously I wasn't here, but I remember hearing this discussion, and I know this has been going on for a long time. And I'm just trying to figure out where the percentages came from. My understanding from the stuff that was in here was the issue was one of usage of the users of the water department should get the benefit. But on the other hand, the water towers were built on a bond issue, which the whole town paid for. And so I'm just trying to balance that of it makes sense that the people who are using the water would benefit, but on the other hand,
I think the basis of the Water Commission's request is because they're now paying $90,000 a year for the painting project that we completed. So I don't think that, I think that they're beyond, you know, who paid to build it. I think it's more a reflection on the maintenance contract that we now have for the South Water Tank.
Okay.
I don't want to speak for all the Water Commissioners, but I think that in their mind, it was their reason for their request of 65-35 was to have a 2-year step to get to 100% to the Water Commission and 0% to the general fund. It sounds like you're more thinking of a 3-year.
We're doing it 3 years, they're doing it 2 years.
Yeah.
All right, so.
I would favor the 65-35 because it seems to me this is an issue of revenue shock to one party and revenue need on the other, and their need seems magnified by the tank maintenance, which seems to me to that it would be reasonable to simply accelerate the transfer.
Okay, I think both positions are reasonable. Myself, I'm in favor of the 50-50, you're in favor of 65-35. If you three guys could weigh in to give Joe a little direction for this coming year, 50-50.
I'll go 60-40.
60-40. That happens all the time in budget. We do this all the time. So we got a compromise.
60-40.
60-40, make it, Joe, okay? There we go. That's a compromise.
We're getting somewhere now.
Did you want to weigh in on the 60-40?
No, I think I mean, Joe's explanation sort of supports that.
Could be an extra $18,000.
Yeah. There's a memo that Ann did in the back of your packet. I think what we've decided, sorry to
cut you off
here, but you know, we looked at this with the DRB. We looked at this was one of Josh's priority projects for the year, which is a reasonable thing to look at. I think that the problem that we have is that, you know, we have three options. One's at $7,500, one's at like $14,000, one's at $18,000. Quite honestly, the $7,500 option and the $15,000 option are a waste of money. Either you got to go all in or you don't do it. It's not at the AV, the meeting room tech, was not in my original proposal. If you want to add it in, it's, you know, $18,000 to $20,000.
Okay, now the one thing I want to clarify though is I think it's universally accepted that our speakerphone is not up to par.
Yeah.
For us or for the DRB or frankly any committee that needs to use it. And but I was told that we do have a better one coming, is that
that's
correct?
That problem's gonna fix itself because we're in the midst of replacing the phones in the town.
Okay. Well,
so that problem's gonna fix itself for free.
All right, so let's keep moving. Who is in favor then of keeping it the way Joe had it, which is zero in the budget, and who wants to add this 18,000 or something else?
Well, I'm certainly the reason I brought this up was I think this is something that is of great benefit to the whole town, and certainly the audience in the room and the audience remotely. And I think that has been a big gap that I've seen is the ability for remote participation, which will be helped somewhat by the speakerphone. But I think both from the on the record review issue and just allowing people to see all the materials and have easy access, it just seems like one of those things that we need to come into the digital age, so to speak, and allow the members of the town to really have a good insight as to what happens at all these different meetings.
Okay, after that, does that mean you're in favor of increasing the tax rate by $18,000?
Yes.
Okay. I'm not. What about you guys? You guys and you.
Well, I maybe it's important to say this now. These are not all of the same priority to me. Some ads are more important in my view than others. So while I would support the ad, that doesn't mean that if it came down to a choice between it and Highway Employee Edition that I would favor it. So I don't want my feelings to be misunderstood. I'd like us to consider the item for a period of time.
Well, why don't we do this, Jerry, to be fair? Because you make a great point. We're going down in the list, and it really skews things a bit. Why don't we do this?
sort of in or out.
Yeah, well, and then at the very end, when we finish it, we'll give anybody a chance to go back to re-argue based on what the final total is.
Yeah, I think it would be wise to look at the, to see where we're happiest in total add and rate, and then prioritize some of these items. There's another item sitting right over there in the, next to the window. Now, I've got a few more to add.
He's not talking about you, Aaron.
So in this case, I'm very supportive of the idea because I believe it's a service to the public and that we need, one of the themes of Joe's budget this year has been to make a full transition to a technical transition to the digital world, and this is an important step in it.
Great. I think you make great points, and in a different world, when we weren't at 3.4% and going up, I'd say yes. Frankly, I'd probably say yes to all of it in a different world, but we are at 3.4% already, and I find that to be a very high number to begin with, so I'm not in favor of adding additional amount to this. So what do you guys think?
I guess, you know, my comment is that I would like to see what the impact of the conference phone is and consider this in next year's budget.
Okay, so you're with me for this year, I think. And Colleen, same?
Yep, I would love to do it. I feel like that we have other priorities.
Okay, next is town manager expenses, pilot projects, and that's $12,000. And if you could explain that for everyone again, Joe?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, a lot of things come up during the year. Just saying, for example, this gate at Sinishore Drive, we had a group of eager citizens that lived in the village who wanted to do some pilot projects, who wanted, you know, restripe lines. All those are great things, but they oftentimes are not thought about at this time of the year. So I think, you know, either next year the answer needs to be no, or we need to have a little bit of extra funds laying around that I have the ability to kind of implement these smaller projects around that come up during the year that seem like great ideas but really don't have funding. So either you're going into the budget saying the answer is no to everyone who comes in with a new idea, or we really need to set aside some money for it. And, you know, 12,000 might not be the number, but I guess generally speaking, is that...
Well, I have some thoughts on it, but let me give everybody a shot first. Why don't we start from you for this time, John?
Conceptually, I'm okay with, some funding set aside. Specifically, I think 12,000 is too much. I think maybe half that or 5,000 might be a number to start with and see how it goes, but to do something. Because Joe is right. We need to be responsive to, you know, the citizens, but we need an account or some money to draw from to do that. So without, you know, shifting from highway or somewhere else, you know. So it seems to me to make sense.
Okay, so you're in favor of a lesser amount?
Yeah.
5 or 6,000, right? Colleen, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree with John. Great. You know, we want to be responsive and encourage participation. But it's hard for me to rationalize this kind of nebulous line item. And so 12,000 seems a little high too.
Okay, so you'd be good with 5 or 6 also? And why don't you guys just pick one of those numbers?
Five.
Five, okay. All right, you guys, what are your thoughts?
I'd be more content with 10 for the reason that there are seem to me two approaches here. One, to solicit funds for these special needs from individual departments over a year, but the budget is not set up in that way. The department budgets are tight, and therefore I think there's rationale for monies being available to the town manager. And in this case, I think 10 is a more appropriate number than 5.
Okay, so we have two people at 5, one at 10. What do you think?
Well, I like Jerry's idea. I mean, that I think that, you know, I think the Sinusure Drive thing is a good example of isn't that more of a highway project than a town manager project? And if there's any way of essentially tapping into the relevant budget to meet these needs, I think that's the way to go. But in any case, I'm more in the 5,000 range than the 10,000 range.
So you're at 5. We've got 3 people at 5, 1 at 10. Would you guys like to leave it at 5, or would you like to go to 6 as kind of a compromise? How's that? I'm trying, Jerry. I'm trying. Is that, would you be?
I'll figure something out for you.
Okay.
I get the direction.
All right. Thank you. And perhaps we could use it for library cleaning.
Yeah. Well, you know, so some of these, again, I don't want to steal the select board's thunder, but for example, the library cleaning, I would probably put this back in the budget anyways. I mean, I'm the one that's been prodding Laura and the trustees to add this. So for me to take it out is just be.
I got to tell you, I think it's ridiculous that our town librarian is cleaning.
Yeah, no question about that.
Yeah.
You know,
it's just no question.
Okay, so does Josh and John, everybody in on it?
I think it needs to be in there.
All right.
Further, the interesting thing here is that a generous amount of these ads relate to staffing. And I do think the town faces, in its current setup, a serious service loss in the near future if we don't address some of the staffing questions, not least of which are the ads to Peter, a recommendation that I'm making for additional pay for the rec department head, the additional employee in the highway department, further monies for extending the South Burlington stormwater contract. Basically, those are all means of addressing staffing needs that I think we face in a serious way. And in the case of the library, I just don't think that's an appropriate task of either the staff or certainly not the trustees.
Oh, I don't know. The trustees could do good.
however better they may do it, you know.
All right. Next up, let's try to keep this moving, is finance assistant hours.
Yeah. So, I'm not sure the amount that is. Peter went over this with the board. I mean, this is probably not something I'll add back into the budget, but I just want to be clear. Peter's department's still going to be understaffed, even if and when we hire a second assistant at 30 hours. It really should be a second assistant at 40 hours. You know, it's a tough thing to do, but there's a lot of work to do in that department, and I know that Peter said to you, even at 30 hours, he's getting 10 or 20 hours more than he should be, but he's...
Than he
is currently, but, he's probably, 30 hours a week less than what he really needs.
Does it make sense to you to ask Peter if... I don't want to put you on the spot, so you don't have to respond if you don't want to, and the microphone's really low for some reason. But if you bend down and speak into the microphone.
It's a budget microphone. Here's the microphone.
It's just an idea how far we're going to go on the number.
Yeah, it's a budget microphone. Oh,
this is the budget microphone.
And if it doesn't go in the FY 2018 budget, I don't want anyone to think that it won't show up in 2019 or 2020. I mean, we're still, even if we have it down at 30 hours this year, at some point it's going to have to get kicked up to we're artificially deflating the budget by keeping it at 30 hours.
I would just comment, as Jerry did, that I think it's important that we address this type of thing head on and not try to, kick that can down the road. So I'd be in favor for adding this kind of thing in.
I think just from a practical standpoint and from a hiring standpoint, I mean, I think it's a lot easier to hire good people at a full-time rate than a three-quarter time rate, and I think that may affect the kind of people that might be available for the position, and I think Peter deserves the best kind of staff that we can get.
Yeah, hiring, of course, is Joe's bailiwick. So, Joe, this is a staffing
Well, so I see here, I think I'm hearing from the select board that you do see it as a value, and Peter and I will circle back around if we think it's appropriate to add it up to 40 hours. So that's, okay. It's nice to hear that.
I think that's good. All right, next is highway employee addition. The only, the real question I have is the $80,000
It's a guesstimate.
Number here. I know, but it's, to me, if you're paying somebody $40,000 and you're going to give them $40,000 and is there, where's the other 40 coming from?
So, you know, look, I put a number in there. It's certainly not an exact number, but depending on how much overtime is and depending whether or not they're a family plan, I mean, I don't want anyone to kid themselves. It gets expensive pretty quickly, and you have to assume it's going to be a family health insurance plan, and probably should assume there's going to be a certain amount of overtime. So it might not be exactly 80, but it's not like 50,000.
You know, it is interesting that because about 4 or 5 years ago, the then select board tried to add an employee to this department, and Paul Goodrich did not want us to do that.
Well, he put this in his budget request, and I took it out. And, you know, we're obviously going to be, looks like we're going to be taking over more road infrastructure with Harrington Avenue, which makes sense, but we're probably going to be taking over other road infrastructures. So it's, mm-hmm. it's reasonable. Well, I don't know if 2018 is the right year, but it's coming.
Plus, well, he's got some, please. He's got some changes in his garage.
Right.
That are going to be
up.
Monumental. And they're
going
to
they're
going to result likely in some contracting out of work.
Good.
And I think that I feel badly that we are in effect relying on Paul's goodwill at 4 o'clock every morning. And at some point we have to recognize that he needs some additional help, and I would strongly urge this inclusion of this item.
Joe, what about a halfway measure? Is about doing a halftime employee? Is that reasonable? Is that not? Tell me if it's not reasonable. I'm just throwing it out for discussion.
It might not be reasonable, but I would talk to Paul. I'll talk to Paul more about that.
I think the balance is that, you know, with the additional stormwater work that is looming for us, that hiring or staffing at a full-time rate in Paul's department will give us some flexibility to do some of that work ourselves. I'm not going to sit here and pretend that we're going to do it all, but it will give us the bandwidth to do a little bit more of that work ourselves, and, you know, save ourselves some money, if you will, as we go into this. So I think that's one thing that we, you know, tend to overlook, that that's coming, but that's really coming. And be the same people doing that work, whether we're contracting it or Paul's doing it. So
the only thing I'm worried about is we're at 3.4 and we add $80,000 to it. We are not mm-hmm. close to 3.4%, mm-hmm. not close anymore. Mm-hmm. So
well, I think that, you know, I don't want to dwell on that until Peter and Joe have had a chance to go back and recompile this and bring the picture back.
Why
to
don't
us.
You guys do that? I think you have an idea from this board. You know, that we want to address the need for someone else in the highway department, but we want to consider the cost too.
Yeah, I'm just curious, just from what was in the details. I mean, right now we're, and from what you said about sort of about overtime issues. I mean, there's already, I think, in the budget there or in the statement there was, we're paying $25,000 a year in overtime, and so would have adding a new person sort of eliminate that overtime?
I don't think you'd have. I don't think you'd have a one-for-one savings. Yeah. It's probably not something to. It's yeah. No.
We've
I mean,
tried
think,
that.
You know, when there's snowstorms, they're just going to be out there.
But John made a point that I didn't think of, and that, and mentally, have already reduced my idea of expanding the South Burlington contract, because that's a very real possibility.
Yeah.
That we could take in house some.
Cleaning the drains and
yeah,
things
if
like
not,
that?
Yeah, if not, there's a labor exchange potential there, though. That's a really good point. No. My feeling is that 3.4 at the moment is what it is at the moment. We don't know school. I think there's a lot of calculation yet to be done before we're really looking at a figure that's representative, and that it's kind of early possibly to be making decisions based on a number that could change radically in time.
Okay. All right, next is highway paving. This 10,000, that was, if I remember correctly, Paul had put in 340,000 and
I think 345 to go up, because right now you have 340 budgeted, and the idea, at least last year, was to start kind of staying on a diet of increasing it every so slightly every year. For the budget that I gave you last week, I had to take some away to make it work. So I guess the question to the board is, are you committed to kind of staying on an incremental increase approach to the paving, or are you willing to take the foot off the gas because of some of the other competing interests?
It's a tough call. This is the one area where I've always held, we either pave our roads every year or we rebuild them at a
much more
huge increase every failure, which is 8 years or whatever it is. Paving's a lot cheaper. It's just a lot cheaper for the town. So this is not an area that I want to drop. And when we factor in the additional roads that we take on all the time, particularly when you compare it to 10 years ago, and then when you factor the, I suppose, a 25% increase in materials that Paul spoke of this year, right off the bat, that's less paving we can do. So this is, I'm committed to trying to keep our tax rate down as low as we can. So I vote against some of these things just because of that, but this is not one of those things.
See, here's an example where this is a roughly a 3% increase. Its efficiency is half because the paving costs are going to be increasing. But I'd rather see this out than staff provision out. So in a perfect world, if we could do both, but I'd rather see the employee add than a $10,000 increase in paving this year.
You know, is that something that, you know, you make a good point, and I think it's reasonable that you can disagree on this, but what would Paul prefer? Do you know, if you went back to Paul and you asked him, it's his department, and we said, look, we can do this or this, but we can't do both. What do you prefer? And actually, I don't even know how much he cares, because he takes the money and does what he wants anyway. It's Paul Goodrich.
Well, I mean, we'll circle back with him and ask him.
Yeah,
so.
I mean, that's a good,
I think that would be a good
point.
That's a good,
yeah.
But, you know,
good
if we approve the $80,000 and then he's unable to fill that spot and he has extra money in his budget to do extra paving with fewer guys. Is that essentially how the math will work out in his department?
Yeah, I'll bet you that's what he
could.
Said.
It could work out that way.
He's a devious.
Yeah. But once you add an employee, I mean, that's kind of a cost that you're going to have forever and ever and ever, you know, paving every year you can kind of take a little bit away. But once you add an employee, you got to figure that cost is going to increase by 3 or 4% every single year. So
next is beach house designs. This is $8,000, not for a new beach house. If the ad would be just for designing.
Yeah.
A new beach house.
Yeah, I think the idea would be to put money in there. The rec commission indicated that, you know, it's interested in rehabbing the beach house, which certainly needs it. And it probably costs us about $8,000 to have designs done similar to what we've done with the library to get to a point where it could then be permitted and then built. And we think that the total cost of construction will be roughly $150,000, but we need to invest $8,000 in to get it to that point.
So if we put the library in the beach house.
What if you? We'd have the best library around.
We use the beach consistently throughout the summer, and I think the beach house definitely needs some work. But I think that I'd like to see a little bit more work done. I feel like $8,000 for designs and $150,000 for a 16 by 10 foot building seems high.
Yeah, I mean, the cost could come down once the designs are finalized. I mean, the estimates that we had were a 1 hour consultant and a very broad brushed.
Yeah.
So, you know, we won't have final numbers until.
Look, if we had $80,000 for an employee, we're over 4%.
Oh yeah, you're well over that.
You know, we're probably well over 4%. So
I agree with the comment about the design. I'd much rather put that $8,000 toward make it available to Joe for a potential increase in pay for the recreation department head first. Second, I'm not so sure there might not be some innovative ideas of involving design groups such as those that design small residences and whatnot that might be interested to take on such a project, or sponsors that might be willing to sponsor design interests, and even from UVM. So I would certainly rate this as a very low priority, if one at all, and with in that case substitute compensation, department compensation for that amount.
Okay, Josh, I haven't heard from you on this one.
Yeah, I mean, I think they're all very good comments on this one. I mean, I think it goes back to what we said before, you know, looking at things at the end and sort of say which where do you want. But I think Jerry's idea of going back to the staff issues as being the priority.
I've added that rec department person as a discussion item before you even started. Because I think it was just an inadvertent omission, because we talked about it last week.
Yeah.
So I think you're getting the idea that that's a low priority compared to the others.
Yeah.
Next is CBC, that's Commission Boards and Committees, or Committees, Boards and Commissions. Frank, they can never remember which support. Total is listed as $15,000, and Joe, why don't you tell us again what that would cover?
It's a little bit like the town manager expenses, but for example, the Ethics Committee requested $2,500. And I think a lot of the other committees kind of requested $1,000 here and $2,500 there, and before you know it, I don't know if it was exactly $15,000, but it was a significant amount.
The Planning Commission gets pizza all the time, right. And we don't.
So I got, you know, the question, I guess, just philosophically is, I think currently CBC support might be about $3,500.
Yeah.
Are you in favor of increasing that? And if so, by a minuscule amount or by a substantial amount? $15,000, I would say, is a substantial amount.
I'd say it's a substantial amount, too. Thoughts?
In fact, last week's, there was a whole lot of discussion amongst the different committees about tree removal. Is that included in this?
I think we already put it's not included.
No. It's in another place.
It's in the budget, but it's not included in this part.
Okay.
All right, so
I'm on the minuscule end of this. I think that, you know, we have to take them one at a time, and you know, if the town manager's discretionary fund is adequately funded, then this kind of goes away in the sense of being able to have monies available to do some of this.
So are we in agreement, keep it where it's at, where Joe had it, which is probably $3,500? Is that right, Peter?
Or maybe a slight increase.
Okay, good.
$3,500 sounds right.
Good. Next is, it says village safety radar signs per unit at $5,000. This has to do with a group of people who, and then there was a loosely formed committee, which I believe Jerry and Joe were part of, who are advocating for slowing devices in or about Falls Road and Marset Road and that area. It does set a precedent that could be very difficult for the town, in that there are so many other areas in town where people complain about speed. And if we put signs here, I've heard this from several people this week, if we put signs here, someone's going to want signs on Woodhaven, on Martindale, on Irish Hill Road,
mm-hmm.
you know, on Spearwood Road, on Shelburne Heinsberg. I mean, we had a whole study about 2 years ago. Jeremy Mikowski did a fantastic study for the town talking about how we could use things. So it's going to be a very difficult decision if we vote for permanent signs here and say, yeah, we'll do it here, but we're not gonna do it here, 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 and here.
See, I guess I interpreted different, is this, because back to our CIP discussion about the mobile, we talked about getting mobile signs, and that's what I interpreted, is this been...
These are the permanent ones.
No, yeah, but I was thinking, we don't have, I don't think we, Joe, were there in the budget for additional mobile ones?
No, they're much more expensive.
I have to look back to see if they...
See, I thought they were about the same.
I think they're approximately twice the cost. I think they're about $10,000.
Yeah.
And I would be in favor of a mobile sign before I was in favor of a permanent sign, but because of budgetary constraints, it, when I compare it to everything else, it's tough. Unless you, a person who doesn't care what the tax rate is, or you, I shouldn't put it that way, you feel the increase in the tax rate is not as important as getting all the things we want on the wish list.
Well, again, I don't want to be too early in making a decision based on a tax rate. I think it's important to incorporate all of the workable ideas that have majority support on the board, so that Joe's got a sense of what to do next in the iterative process. I'd be very hesitant making a decision on what is really an abstract number at this point. And in that case, I would argue to bump this to 12, which would account for the 20% expendable budget that's required to get the local motion pilot program in place, which can visit a number of locations in town, and a movable, portable, movable speed cart that can go to other locations.
So 12 is approximately one portable cart and 2 grand for the local motion.
And the 20% for local motion.
And I just want to address one thing, and Jerry, maybe it's just semantics, but you know, the number that you have, even though I'm calling it initial budget and I'm telling you that it, we're gonna scrub it and we're gonna tighten it up, I don't want it to be presented as an abstract number. It's pretty complete with some modifications. I don't,
I think you should
treat that 3.5% increase or whatever as relatively absolute.
I'm talking about if we began with a decision as to what would be a tolerable, acceptable tax increase and then budgeted from there, that wouldn't be abstract to me. But if we're in the process of deciding what eventually the priorities will be and at what expense, a number now of closeout number now seems to be more abstract than not. There's nothing abstract about the budget you're doing or the numbers, and in fact about the wonderful job you've done.
Yeah, no, I'm not.
Yeah.
I just want to, if you add back in pretty much everything that we've said here, you're probably at like a 7% increase, I'm just guessing.
Yeah, well.
So I don't know what the, you know, add everything back in.
That'll be a heck of a...
That'll be an opportunity to cut some things.
If I had everything back in.
Yeah, well, we've got some things that we, the board as a whole, have indicated to you that they don't want to increase.
Yeah,
yeah.
You know, so village safety, we've heard a couple of things. Sense of the board, at this point, I think Jerry's in favor of increasing it by 12,000. I'm in favor of keeping it at zero. What do you three guys think?
I think given the discussion and the degree of concern, I think a lot of these things go to speak to the issue of what kind of services do the residents of the town expect, and what kind of responsiveness do they expect from the select board. And so I think given that these traffic issues are coming up over and over again, I think speaking to that need and that those desires, I think sends a message that we think these things are important.
But don't you think the residents also expect the select board to respond to trying to keep the tax rate down?
Right, and I think there's all sorts of different ways of doing that as well.
Right, so what do you guys think?
I guess my comment is that, you know, I think some monies need to be carried in that line item. I think the mobile approach versus a, you know, static or fixed approach is probably what we should consider and go forward from there.
Colleen?
I agree with John that if we're gonna consider a radar signage, I like the idea of it being mobile because I can tell you that.
I agree with that completely. If we go with the sign, I completely agree it should be mobile.
So as far as for this year's budget, and I, Josh, I think you're right. What do town people expect as far as like timeliness and ability to increase our budget? And I think putting some money into this line item, enough to have locomotion look a little bit more carefully, not just for that area, but another area, is a sign that we're interested, a sign that we're supportive, and then follow it up next year with looking into a mobile sign. So I'd be in favor of having this at like 2,500 and investing it in locomotion.
Okay, well, look, you have our thoughts. Why don't you do what you think? It's your budget until the end of the year, and then we can hash it out on
sure.
the 10th.
And then are there, I mean, you know, I know, are there any other items that are either in the budget now
no,
that,
there's a couple,
you know,
there's, I have another one I want to talk about. And that is, that didn't make the list, and I think it's just an inadvertent oversight. We talked about addressing Betsy Siplicki's salary. That is your call, but from getting, having funding in the budget, we have an exceptional talent, committed, driven, experienced, kind, competent, professional, you know,
loyal.
I mean, she's like perfect.
She's <a
best out. laughs> she deserves to be paid commensurate with what the position should be paid. And we've learned that it's under that. I don't think we have the exact number, but I think we should budget something to make it possible for you, when in your role as town manager, to bring that up to speed, just like we have in the past with the town clerk, the town finance director, the town librarian. We want to, at least I want to be a part of a responsive board for salaries, so when we get good people, we keep them, and we should, loyalty is a two-way street.
And I agree with that, but in other examples that you just brought up, we did this in a tiered, in a stepwise fashion, so
mm-hmm.
we did it over 3 years, so it was a little bit more absorbable into the budget.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have to be 3 years, like 2 years, something.
Yep.
But
have you had time to do that?
Not thoroughly. We started looking at it, but I get the direction.
Okay, so why don't you have the direction, and by January 10th, hopefully we'll have a little more direction, and we can address it to whatever inappropriate. Is everybody supportive of it?
Yes.
Yes?
Yeah, I spoke to it earlier.
Yeah.
No question.
All right. And then I think Jerry, I don't want to skip it, for another ad, had at the beginning you mentioned stormwater, the relationship with South Burlington.
We discussed potentially expanding the South Burlington contract. Now, part of that issue is timing, correct, Joe? About whether it would be useful to do it, whether we needed to do it in this budget, or whether it would be useful. And
Jerry, I think for what you were describing, I think the money that's in the budget will be sufficient.
All right.
To get us to where I think that you
to
are.
The desired compliance
level.
Yes.
That,
all right.
And I think next year we're going to have a real serious discussion about
utility.
Funding, whether it's a stormwater utility,
right.
or whether it's a something else.
No question about that.
We have to do that. All right, so we've done the ads. If no one has any additional ads.
All right.
I said we'd go back to give everybody a chance for, based on what we kept or didn't keep. Does anybody want to make an additional argument for any of the other items?
Let me just clarify. I mean,
you still have a chance January 10th.
Well, I mean, going back to other issues that I don't think are on this list as well, on the negative.
Oh, you mean taking out? That's
other
what
things,
we're going to do
other
next.
Things. Okay. All right.
All right. So that's it? Okay, good. So now, who has anything they'd like to talk about that was in the proposed budget that they would like to either eliminate or reduce? And anybody ready to start? Go ahead. Josh?
Well, I'm just going to go back to a question I raised on the
all-day meeting on Wednesday, in at least the budget, in the budget book, there was listed a 3% COLA, and I wondered about...
2%.
Well, it's listed in here as 3%.
I think at the, I think on one thing, but it's actually put in there in the budget at 2%.
Well, I think reality is, and because this puzzled me, the Bureau of Labor Statistics North New England Index right now is at 1.6%. We know that Social Security is going to go up 0.7%. And so I think whatever COLA we decide, I think certainly staff deserve whatever is the most appropriate, but I think relating to what the residents of Shelburne are potentially going to get in the COLA for their jobs across, we should be in line with what the figures say.
It sounds like you're advocating for a departure from what the town has done for years. For years, the town has not done a COLA based on 1 year. For years, the town has done COLA based on the previous 3 to 5 years. So are you advocating a change?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, I think unless there's there's good justification, it seems like my experience is that COLAs are usually based on what the cost of living index states on a yearly basis. Certainly that's what's done on a national and federal basis.
I think it might be wise to at least keep it at 2%, especially because the collective bargaining agreement for the police department will not be known until after town meeting, and that negotiation will set the cost of living at least for a number of employees, so I think that leaving at 2% is probably a reasonable bet. We're not going to be able to guess it 100%, but
I'm guessing that we could be seeing serious labor issues less than 2%. Okay.
We can look at it closer.
You know,
John,
fine. Right? You know,
that's fine.
We'll
that's my comment.
Anything else for striking from the budget?
Well, I have a trade.
I want Bryce Harper.
I'd like to trade a reduction in select board expenses and an equal increase in managers' expenses following our discussion of ICMA attendance, which we all may recall.
Yep.
The ICMA meeting, that's the International City Managers Association.
If you give me the extra expenses, I may use on something else. It's hard to get to that conference because it's so busy here. So it's unlikely that I will.
Well, it's a budget. Doesn't mean it has to be spent, but it's there.
So the select board discretionary fund, I think you're referring to,
it was 8,500.
8,500.
I'd reduce that by 700 and increase the town manager's expenses by 700 from 2,300 to 3,000.
But
didn't we just increase the town manager's expenses by $6,000?
I'll definitely look at it.
No, it's a different.
Gary, I'll look at those.
Oh, you're talking about the expenses, personal expenses.
This
okay.
is a revenue-neutral proposal.
Okay.
Why don't you take a look at that, and then we can always address it.
Thank you.
Anything else? Anyone else have any?
I'm good.
Negatives?
All right, we'll give it our best shot.
I just want to give everyone else an opportunity to address anything else about the budget that we haven't talked about yet, recognizing that it's still the town manager's budget at this point. Nothing? Okay.
All right.
But wait a second. Any comments from anybody? You guys are over there smiling,
having
fun.
The best time. Okay.
All right.
All right. I'll give it my best shot.
Thank
you.
Joe and Peter,
draft.
Thank you again for the excellent work.
Thank you.
Next item is item number 9. Discuss library building plans and consider...
Oh, shoot, you know what, you have to take the action item.
Oh, yeah,
sorry,
we have to work. Oh, I'm sorry. It's a good thing you're here. Who would like to consider warning a public hearing for fiscal year 2018 Shelburne General Fund budget for January 10th, 2017?
So moved.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by Jerry. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. I just skip that. 9, discuss library building plans and consider financing options. This is not a decision item, So, Joe, am I going to turn it over to you? Am I going to turn it over to Laura? Or am I going to turn it over to the library trustees, the steering committee, or to Jerry?
I'll turn it over to Laura quick. But, you know, look, there's been a priority for the select board and the trustees. We've been working hard. Obviously, last week you saw our final plans, and I think now it's at least reasonable to start thinking about the funding part of this. It's not a decision item for a reason. We should at least have a discussion tonight.
Thank you for having me on the agenda tonight. I appreciate it. I'll try to be quick because I know we're a little behind. I'm Laura Keenan, I'm your library director. And I first need to start by calling a steering committee concurrent meeting to order because we have a quorum here. So AJ will be taking notes. So I wanted to just remind us as sort of context what the mission of the steering committee was, because all of this stems from that, directly from that. And as a reminder, what you guys passed, what the trustees passed, was the main thrust of it is for us to formulate and implement a comprehensive plan to solve the space and maintenance issues of the library, but also taking into consideration some of the town's needs with this complex. And as you may remember, some of the building issues we've been having include flooding, not environmentally friendly building, a lot of HVAC issues, and our space issues. As you know, we shove ourselves into little places. We turn people away from programs because we don't have space. And we also don't have good one-on-one places for people who try to use our building in that way. So these are some pretty big things that we're trying to solve. And you guys made it a priority in April. That gave us some great energy to vault forward with this project, and we've gone a long way in just a few months, thanks to your support and the support of the trustees. And we've been engaging the public, as you heard last week, pretty extensively for several months, getting really great feedback from a large percentage of your public about what they want to see in this new building. If we dreamed big, what would it be? If we dreamed more responsibly, what would that be? Keeping in mind that this fits in the context of a lot of other priorities for the town, and we have to keep that in mind as we try to figure out what we're going to do. So we hired some architects, who I hope you love just as much as we do. You saw Andrea last week. She gave you the final concept, which I'm very excited by. It's still a moving target in some ways because we are trying to simplify it even more to keep costs down as much as possible. And that plan that you saw last week is before some professional cost estimators who are really going to break it down so we know exactly how much, within a very close percentage, each part of the project will be, so that as the town we can figure out how much this we can afford to do at once, or if we need to break it up into different pieces. You may remember a long time ago we came to you because we had done a couple feasibility studies, and those feasibility studies told us at that point that it would be very challenging for us to do this whole project through public, through private fundraising.
Can I stop you just for 1 second?
Yeah.
Could you tell me, is she getting picked up? Because it sounds a little odd from up here.
Yeah.
It's okay?
Okay.
All right, thanks. Sorry.
And so I've been spending the last 2 years trying to develop some really good relationships with potential funders, and they've been pretty clear with me that they're interested, but that this is a public project, and so we need to figure out how to publicly finance it. So that's what we're working on right now. So we're working with the cost estimators to figure out what that means, and then in your meeting on the 3rd, we'll come back with some more details for you to discuss and really start considering with us what this might mean for the future of this project. Do you have any questions about that? I don't have any details to give you at this point because the cost estimators are working on it. But do you have any questions for me before I go on to, I have a little treat to share with you.
No.
You gotta open up the,
So you may know that for the past month, we've been asking folks to engage with us, sharing stuff from the heart about what this public building and the staff and what we're doing for them, what that means to them. We have about 67 people giving us responses so far, little videos, and we wanted to give you a really short snippet. It's about 2 minutes and 50 seconds of really highly cut together responses just for you to see. I mean, I think this is a great time of year where we're all expressing our love for one another, and I'd love to share this with you.
Ways. I like that the library provides a lot of kid activities. It's just a great community resource. So I really hope we can go forward with the library and make it, keep it as a really important centerpiece of our town.
I like the library.
books that I'd like to read them.
Part of a family history. My daughter actually worked here when she was 12 years old. My wife would just practically live here with the kids and go through all the books. And I think it really helped them to be successful in college, where they both graduated with honors. And my son's going on to get his PhD, so I think the library gave him a great start.
Immeasurably important. The Pearson Library in particular saved my bacon. I got involved with storytelling and stuff after I came through cancer treatment, actually, and getting involved and working with the children. I'm sure that all helps you heal.
I've loved books my whole life. I've been a reader my whole life, and this is a sanctuary and a place of liveliness and meeting. It's a library is a place for sharing, and it's a place for equity, and it gives the community more bang for their buck than any other thing I can think of, because everyone can enjoy the resources.
I do a men's book group through the library, the list of Vermont, so if you want audiobooks through the library.
As a matter of fact, we're going to the library right after we leave here today. How about that? My son and I have been going there ever since he was a baby, and we would go for story time every week. And since then, he has also grown into loving the library as well.
And what's most important to me about the Pearson Library is it is a safe haven for our kids. We have 750 kids between preschool and eighth grade, and I can tell you on any given day, probably between 30 and 50 kids will let us know either that's where they're headed after school, if they're there just basically keeping themselves safe. Every community needs a gathering point, and it's great there's books and technology. Those are all things that draw the kids there, and it's a safe place that they can be. We're really fortunate to have it in our community.
Would be that offers the same access to everyone, regardless of your color or creed, or whether you're rich or poor, or old or young. Everyone has the same access to everything that the library offers.
So we have, like I said, 60 plus of these that we'll be editing together and sharing with the community after the new year. And thank you for letting me share that with you. I really appreciate it. Do you have any questions for me?
Well done. Well done.
Anyone have anything?
Can you just share when the cost estimator thinks that they'll be done?
Yeah, so the cost estimator should, his deadline with us is 2 days from today. So we'll have it on Thursday, and the steering committee will be meeting to really go over that on Friday in depth. And then we'll bring that before you on your meeting, hopefully on the 3rd.
Anything else from anyone?
All I would say is, we're not asking for a decision from the board, obviously, but is it worth your time, at least at the next meeting? There's only a few meetings until you sign the town meeting warning on January 24th. And is this something that you're willing to at least consider on the warning? If so, then it's worth our time to work on it. If not, maybe it's, we have to think about that.
To clarify that, you're asking?
I'm getting a sense of the board.
Sense of the board, whether we want to consider a ballot item for...
of some sort. I mean, there hasn't been a number. We don't have numbers, but, you only have so much time between now and January 24th,
and this is
we only have so much time.
And you're not talking about the bond item number that we had spoken about in the past, which was closer to the $500,000 to some people mentioned $1 million, but now you're talking about a much larger number, right?
I don't know if that's true or not. But
is that?
The suspense.
Likely.
Well, There's no other. I don't mean anything more by it besides I'm guessing you're at least willing to get the information and consider it on January 3rd and take it from there.
Yeah, I think so.
Absolutely.
I think we need the information.
That's perfect. So we can go from there.
Great.
Can't wait.
Good video.
Thank you for your time.
I like the suspense, though.
Yeah, you like that? Might find all of it under the trees, that way you don't know.
We got a holiday coming up. All right, next item up is item number 10.
Similar question, but a more firm number.
Discuss proposal from the Shelburne Fire Department to place a bond ballot item to purchase a Quint apparatus on the town meeting warning. Jerry, Chief, sorry, Chief Jerry. I think we, you've been before us several times. We saw you a week ago. The number is, if I remember correctly, 995,000, or give or take.
High end of it.
High end of it. And you, if I'm correct, please correct me if I'm not. You're requesting the select board place a ballot item for the purchase of a Quint truck in the amount of approximately $1 million. So, would you like, before I turn it over to board comments, would you like to say anything else?
If you don't have any questions, obviously.
Well, you've been before, yeah. All right, board members, please, your thoughts.
I've said this before, I think they did a admirable job making a economic case for this, this need. I mean, I think it was well conceived. It's a big number, but if you look at what the needs are, or what the projections are, it seems like a reasonable thing, even though it's a scary number.
Oh, by the way, just so everyone understands, by placing an item on ballot, we went through this with Pond Road a couple of years ago. It was not necessarily an endorsement that we were in support of it, although there certainly is an indication that you are if you put it on. It just means we feel it should be something that goes to town vote. So we, Josh, I think you're in favor of putting it on, right? Jerry?
So am I. I support it wholeheartedly. I think that the economic rationale was carefully drawn, and I think the subsidiary issues of staffing and others like it were addressed squarely and to certainly to my satisfaction. And I again would like to see this the town have an opportunity to vote for this.
Colleen?
I agree with Josh that I think the financial argument was well made, that we're replacing what was it, the rescue vehicle and an engine too. My only concerns are the issue with the Bay Road Bridge, and if we replace it with an engine that we can't use. That's my only worry.
Okay. So are you in favor of putting it on the ballot? Or do you want to wait till all comments?
I'll wait until all comments.
Okay, John?
Just to make one comment to Colleen, I think that because of the lead time to acquire a piece of equipment like this, the Bay Road Bridge is going to have to be dealt with prior to this arriving on the scene, if I could say it that way. And I don't mean that in any negative context, but it just happened to flow very nicely there. But I agree that the group has done a very good job of analysis and packaging this so that everybody that's interested can understand what and the reasons why we need to do something like this. I think that, in my own way of checking with other departments throughout the Northeast here, this is the way they're all headed. So, we're a bit ahead of the curve in the sense of doing this, but this is the way, modern day firefighting will take place, from this point forward. So it makes sense to me to have our citizens have the best approach to this type of thing. And I would also say, I hope we never have to use it, but I think it's important to have it.
So you're in favor of putting
so
it
I would
on
be,
a ballot? I
mean. Yes, absolutely.
All right, well, when Jerry called me this week and promised to let me drive it twice a week. Forgot to mention that. Look, I think this is a tough call. For 8 years, it's been in the capital improvement plan. It was out of the capital improvement plan. It was put back in. It was moved back. It was moved up. There is disagreement, let's face it, within your own department, whether this is a needed apparatus at this time. I am not taking a position of whether it is needed, but I am taking a position that I believe it should be on the ballot.
Okay.
So do you want to add, do you want to weigh in whether you think it should be on the ballot? You don't have to, I mean.
We don't have to, but yeah. And like my only consideration, and I hope that, I hope you're right, I hope Vermont Rail says we need to have a 20, or you know, the next century bridge as well.
The state of Vermont will weigh in.
Yeah, I have, Vermont Railway has put us in a terrible position on this issue. There's no question about it. It has impacted this issue. But I think it's, you guys have waited, your class operation, I mean, top to bottom. Let's face it, if we picked our heroes in our town, it's you guys. So I'll tell you, I'm not sure it'll pass, because we saw what happened with the firehouse a couple of years ago when it was at $2.5 million, and we had a $1 million federal grant, and the townspeople voted it down. So, but I'm with you. I think it should be on. I do know that this is not a decision item on tonight's agenda. So, as far as we still have time, you have a sense of the board, I think, Joe, but it's going to have to be put on the agenda for the next meeting. So, because this is not a decision, so
right.
We're not making a decision.
Yep, next meeting you can assume it will be a decision item, and I'm certainly getting a sense of the board of, it seems like if I was going to bet, it will likely be supported, at least to put on the warning. Not to say you're supporting the effort, but that you'll support that it'll be on the warning. So that's great. I think what the information you wanted to hear.
Tuesdays and Fridays are good for me for my driving. I think Jerry wants Wednesdays and Saturdays.
You know, the rest of us.
Yeah. You get Monday mornings and Sunday afternoons. You get every night between 3 and 5 a.m.
Oh, good.
Because you have 37 children, you're up
then
anyway.
It's the only time I'm, the only time I have free.
Alice, please take the mic.
Very quick.
Alice Wynn.
I just wondered what a Quint apparatus is. I noticed it on the agenda and I
it's the old ladder truck,
it's
extra stuff.
It's a fancy name for ladder.
They changed it to Quint because ladder truck didn't fly with the select board over the it's like the connector road name change.
There's three levels of basically aerial trucks. There's a what they call an aerial apparatus, which is a truck with a bucket on the end of it, which has a platform. There's an aerial ladder, which basically is a larger truck, usually on double axle, rear end, longer ladder. This is a Quint. Basically, a Quint is it's an engine with a ladder on top that serves basically what I call the Quint, which serves five functions in fire service. Like I said, we're replacing two trucks with it. One's an engine, one's a heavy rescue. This truck will carry a lot of equipment. It'll carry water. It'll have a pump. But it'll also give us the access to roofs and second story and higher buildings that we don't currently have access to with ground ladders, because ground ladders are becoming obsolete with the way houses are being built now. So basically, a Quint is just an engine with a ladder on top. And if I may also say, over the next couple of weeks, we're hoping to get something onto our website that people can go and look at. Information-wise, we're hoping to put stuff out to the public in the paper. We encourage anybody who has any questions at all to contact somebody in the fire service and ask your questions so we can get an answer before March. We definitely don't want people coming to the vote blindsided. We want everybody to be very aware of what this truck does for us and what it's for. So.
Yeah.
You gonna drive it into the gym? All right, thank you. Next item is...
Alice? Oh, good idea.
Next item is item 13, 12 haven't been removed. Consider approving 1 year note with National.
11.
Oh, wait, 11.
11. Oh, I'm sorry. As a decision item, consider request for waiving penalty and interest on property tax bills from 107 Summit Circle for $126.20 and 107 Woodbine for $143.94. Are you here for that? Would you like to come to the microphone, introduce yourself? You can lift the mic out or bend over, whatever you want to do.
I don't really have much to add already with the information that I provided. I don't know what happened. In the end, the town did not get me a check for the property tax. All I know that was that I wrote it, I mailed it.
This is for 107 Woodbine.
107 Woodbine, sorry, yes. Yeah, 107 Woodbine. I wrote the check, I put it in the mail, as I've done in the last 2 years, but it just happened the town did not get it. And I got a letter that we were delinquent on our property tax. So I provided the town all the proof that I have that I wrote the check. I think that you probably have included carbon copy of the check that I wrote. And I showed to Peter that I had checks written before and after. I also submitted a bank summary with the information that the check before and after the town property check cleared our bank account. We had enough money in the bank account to pay for the property tax. There was no reason for me not to pay it. So I have no idea what happened from when I mailed the check and how I didn't get here, but all I can prove is that I did write it.
Well, thank you for coming before us. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
No.
When was the check received?
It wasn't.
Oh, it never has been.
No.
But it was cashed?
No, it wasn't cashed. I canceled the check because when I got the letter, I realized that they did not get the check. So I canceled the check, but I wrote a new check. They already have it. I'm not sure what else to add.
I think.
If you have any questions.
I don't think we have any questions. I think you've clearly stated what happened. Does anybody on the board have any questions?
No.
Joe and Peter, let me ask you this. Would granting this waiver request be a departure from the standard that we've established in the town?
Better question for Peter.
I believe in the past we have waived the penalty in situations where the property owner brought in a copy of their check register showing that this check was in sequence. Mrs. Norell did that in this case, showed me her check register. There were checks written before and after the town of Shelburne check. And also I point out that Mrs. Norell also has signed up in the future to have her property taxes taken automatically out of her bank account, so she doesn't have to worry about it getting lost in the mail.
So is it fair to say that it would comply with our past practices and procedures to waive the penalty but not the interest?
Yes, this is a motion to waive the penalty.
Waive the penalty only?
Right. Oh,
I see. Yeah. Penalty and interest.
I thought I saw penalty and interest.
No. Yeah, I wrote the motion wrong.
I think by charter you can only waive the penalty.
Right.
So.
Okay. So is there anything else that anyone would like to add? Joe, anything you'd like to add? Someone like to make a
move to waive the penalty charges for 107 Woodbine in the amount of $143.94.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by anyone?
I'll second.
Seconded by Josh. Any further discussion? Anything anybody else wants to add? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Thank you for coming in. Thank you for your such a nice way of talking to us. We're doing the best we can.
I just wanted to see how this works. I'm here.
Well, thanks for coming.
We do expect you to sing the holidays.
I'll be terrible at that.
Don't stop me. All right, next item. Okay, 12, the Barrett.
There's another one here, but I don't see Mr. Klempner, I guess. So it may be just as well to table that to see if he is able to.
Which one?
There's 107 Summit, or there's also 107 Summit Circle. There's an email
right,
in
well,
there.
Well, they're not here right now, so.
But if he's not here, then maybe we'll try again in the future.
Someone,
so.
Well, it's listed as a decision item.
Someone like to move to table it? Table it without date?
So moved.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by?
Second.
Jerry, discussion, hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Next item up now is 13, consider approving one-year note with the National Bank of Middlebury in the amount of $130,500 in interest rate, 1.8% financing, the purchase of a wastewater department tanker truck. Peter or Joe, whoever?
Peter can go, I mean, we do this fairly regularly. Peter's done a pretty good job of, for some of these longer-term purchases, actually doing better, taking out one-year note after one-year note after one-year note. So we've received authority, I don't know if it's from the voters, I guess, to do the long-term debt, but instead of doing the long-term debt notice, we've been typically doing one-year notes because the interest rates are pretty reasonable, which requires some administrative motion on your part, and to sign this before you leave.
Okay. Someone like to...
So moved?
Moved by Jerry, seconded by...
I'll second it.
John. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
You want to pass that down?
Yeah, please sign. There's a few places to sign.
Couple places? Okay, let's do that before we move on because we keep forgetting to sign these things. I guess while we wait.
Dean did a nice job with that, didn't he?
We can make a motion.
I said Dean did a nice job with it.
Someone like to make a motion to make a finding that premature general public knowledge will clearly place the select board at a substantial disadvantage in regards to litigation with Vermont Rail.
So moved.
Moved by Colleen, seconded by?
I'll second it.
John?
I have a comment.
Sure.
I'd really like to point out that this has been a pretty pro forma thing in the past, that the statement has always been making a finding that premature general public knowledge would clearly place the public body at a disadvantage. Unfortunately, the information that is presented doesn't give me any information of why that would be the case. Often, it's just stated as there's litigation or something else. And I've become quite uncomfortable about the idea of making a finding when I have clearly no knowledge of what disadvantage might be present. So I think it's not a not a good process to continue.
Okay, here's the resolutions to sign.
I think the board's currently in litigation.
Yeah, we're currently in litigation. This is the motion that's been proposed, suggested by the town manager. In this case, I can tell you this has to do with the, and I'm happy to add this, that this has to do with the MSGP, the multi-sector general permit.
But we were not a party to that in litigation, is that correct?
No, that's false.
I thought this was brought by
both of us.
It was brought by both of us. All right. I do think that in a lot of the executive sessions we've had on litigation, I still do not believe that having discussions in the public really would have been any kind of a disadvantage.
And what are those?
I don't think it may not be proper for me to discuss it since it was discussed in executive session. Although I think there are a lot of things that are discussed in executive session that don't necessarily need to be. And a lot of them are decisions, which seem to be decisions, which by open records need to be made in public, and they're not.
I've never heard a motion made, seconded, and voted on in executive session. Have you?
No. And I think there's a problem there.
You think there should be motions in executive session?
No, I do not. but I believe decisions have been made in executive session, which might more rightly be made in public session.
In regard to litigation strategies?
Yes.
And you think litigation strategies should be decided in open session while we were pending litigation?
I think it depends on your definition of litigation strategy. And I think the term is overused and sometimes not appropriately used.
Okay, anybody have any other comments about the motion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
I'm sorry, Jerry, I didn't hear you vote.
I didn't get to it. I was pretty slow in the uptake there, so I'll abstain after the fact.
Okay, yeah. All right. Next is consider a motion to enter executive session to discuss Vermont Rail litigation and invite the town manager. And in particular, unless there's something else I don't know, I'm referring to the multi-sector general permit.
So moved.
Moved by Colleen.
Second.
Seconded by Jerry. And we already discussed this, adding it as item 14A on the agenda. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Nay.
Thank you.